All right, good evening, everyone. It's 6:30, you wanna get started. My name is Sadia, I'm the program manager here at the library. I wanna welcome you all to our 7th Global Neighbor Program to learn about the people who make up our diverse community. Our goal for these programs are so that we can try and live harmoniously and appreciate each other. So it helps to learn about our backgrounds and our cultures. I want to do a special thanks to Chief Lally and Elgin Police Department police officers who are attending our program tonight and supporting us. All right, so tonight's program, we will be talking about India and Pakistan. We are combining it because originally it was one country, it was India, then we departed to two different countries, but they're still similar in cultures and backgrounds, but we'll get a little bit of the differences too. All right, the program is gonna consist of a presentation, then we'll have some music and dance, and then we'll have some food samples. And I wanna do a shout out to Zahid Nahari. They are on Barrington Road in Streamwood. They donated samosa and chole for us. So do try those out. And they also have Pakistani, Indian, and Middle Eastern food. So if you have a taste for any of those, try them out. All right. Before I introduce our speakers, I'm gonna just let you know that I am from Pakistan too. I came when I was 4 years old. So first of all, we have Mansi Patel. She is from India. She works with Family Services Association of Greater Elgin as the Director of Human Resources, Equity and Development. She holds a Master's in Industrial Organizational Psychology and is a SHRM certified HR professional. She was born in India and she came when she was also 4 years old. And she believes everyone's story has value because we all add value to the spaces we find ourselves. Mansi hopes to give you a glimpse of India that has unknowingly shaped her choices, which have brought her success in every part of her life. She is very passionate about advancing equity and social justice. All right, and then for Pakistan, we have Kiran Ansari. She is a Pakistani-American who is proud of both parts of her hyphenated identity. She migrated to Chicago over 24 years ago and has been in Elgin for the last 12 years. She is the assistant editor of the Islamic Horizons magazine and also runs her own small business while raising 3 children. So help me give a warm welcome, and we'll have Mansi come up first.
Thank you so much, Sadia, for that introduction. And thank you also to the Gail Borden Library for hosting this series and having me be speaker on India. And so, as she mentioned, I did come when I was 4 years old. So I did have to look some things up. So my Indian knowledge is not all up to date. But thankfully, thanks to the internet, it is. So I'll cover some background, culture, and interesting facts in the next 10 minutes. So I just hit the next button to advance to thank you. All right, so India is a country in South Asia, and India is actually the 7th largest country by area and the 2nd most populous country since 1950 and has a population of roughly about 1.4 billion. Yeah, that's a lot. And so actually, I think by end of last month, India was estimated to overtake China with their population. India shares land borders with Pakistan to the west, China, Nepal, and Bhutan to the north, and Bangladesh, Myanmar to the east. And I included a picture of the globe here to see that India is actually literally across, like all the way around the world from here. So, a long plane ride. And multitasking is hard, guys. All right, so just a little bit of background about India. Similar to America, India was under British rule. So the British government overtook the Indian administration and called it the British Raj, and that lasted roughly 200 years, so 1757 to 1947. But then in August of 1947, India gained its independence and was officially called the Republic of India. And that effort was led by Mahatma Gandhi, which is a name you might have heard before. Through his effort and his approach of nonviolence and compassion, he was able to bring India to its independence. He was an attorney, a freedom fighter, and a civil rights activist. At the same time that India gained its independence, it also partitioned off, and then Pakistan was also created as its own country, which I know Kiran will talk about in a little bit. And just some fun background facts. This is the final adaptation of India's flag. So we have Indian saffron at the top, which is also orange, white in the middle, and India green at the bottom. And then in the middle, we have a 24-spoke wheel, which is also called the Ashoka Chakra. It is a navy blue wheel, and it is symbolizing Gandhi's goal of making Indians self-reliant by fabricating their own clothing. The colors represent courage and sacrifice, peace and truth, and faith and chivalry. Then we have the emblem with the four lions. So that's at the top right over there. So there's four lions that are standing back to back, symbolizing power, courage, confidence, and faith. The lions are mounted on a circular abacus, which is a math tool, and the abacus is mounted on a lotus, and the wheel of the law is at the center of the abacus. So the wheel, in this regard, symbolizes the progress and the evolution of human civilization. And then the currency in India is called the rupee, and today, present day, the conversion rate is $1 is 81 rupees. And then our national bird is the peacock, which I think is beautiful. So Indians are both religious and spiritual, or they can be religious or only spiritual. The idea is the same, that there is a higher power and there is a strong energy which provides guidance and leadership, however you want to bring that to you. There are many religions in India, but the number one, 80% of the religion is Hindu, 14% is Muslim, and then the last 6% is made up of Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, and Jain. So if you were to Google major gods or deities in India, you may see something like this. So starting on the left, you have the creator. In the middle, you have the preserver and the protector. And then at the far right here is the destroyer. And then often these powers or deities are come in different shapes and forms. So these are other ones that there are many, many gods in the Hindu religion, right? So now I'm talking about Hindu because it is the prominent religion in India. And so some of these you may have seen before. So we have at the top left starting that it is the known as the destroyer, the great god, so one of the principal deities in Hinduism. Then we have the goddess of wealth and prosperity right there in the top middle. And then the goddess of destroying evil and bringing goodness into our life at the top right. And then starting on the bottom row on the left, we have Krishna, which is a major deity, a god of protection, compassion, tenderness, and love. People celebrate his birth every year. And then we have the monkey god right there in the middle on the bottom, and they represent, this is a representation of the destroyer, so they protect you against evil, and they're known to be invincible and immortal. And then finally, we have the elephant god, which is probably one of the most worshipped deities, and remover of obstacles. I'm sure you've heard that before, and someone that is brings you good luck. So there is actually no national language in India, which is surprising because there are over 1,600 languages that are spoken on a daily basis in India. That's a lot. But only 22 of them are actually recognized as official languages. And the two most spoken languages in India are Hindi and English. All right, and then moving on to just some fun holidays. So some of these are, most of these are things that today Indians who have immigrated to Western culture celebrate today. So we have, again, just going from the top right, on the first row we have Diwali, which is the festival of lights, celebrates the victory of good over evil. And then we have the kites, that's a kite flying day. This was actually the first holiday to be added to the Western calendar. It celebrates new beginnings through kite flying, dancing, eating, and carnival-like activities. Then we have, at the bottom, you see someone's hand with some bracelets on. That's called Raksha Bandhan. It symbolizes protection of a brother over a sister, so a sister ties this bracelet. And then we have a Gerba style dance picture in the middle right there, and that is part of Navratri, which is a 9-night celebration leading up to Diwali, so you do a lot of dancing. And then Holi, which is another festival that's become really popular here in America, is the festival of colors. It's a festival of love and grace and just celebrating spring and new beginnings once again. All right, so this is like my favorite part of India is the food. It's you know, so diverse and so delicious. So on the top there, we have Punjabi food. So Punjab is a state in India towards kind of the more northern region. And this food is rich in like paneer, which is a special kind of cheese. There's naan and rice, you know, even samosa. And then we have at the top there on the right, dosa, which is more South Indian food. And then on the bottom there, at the beginning of the row, we have Gujarati food, which is the food that I kind of grew up eating because I speak Gujarati, and that's my, so we have vegetable dishes and roti and rice, and then I have pictures of desserts because we all love desserts. So a lot of a gulab jamun, which I think is something that is being shared today, which is like a fried cheese ball doused in like sugar syrup. So it's really, really good. And then anything with sugar and clarified butter is, yes, a go for us. Yeah. I'm almost done. So, and then this is just the data, and I want to thank the library for providing this data for us. So according to the 2010 census, Chicago is home to about 171,901 Indians. And according to the 2020 census, Elgin is home to 5.4% Asians, which include Indians, Pakistanis, Chinese, Laotian, Thai, Vietnamese, and Korean people. And then in the 1940s, the Lucellar Act made it possible for Indians to become naturalized citizens, which I am especially grateful for because I am a naturalized citizen myself. Indian immigration really took off in the 1990s, and by 2000, 40,000 Indian immigrants were coming here every year, and today that number is roughly about 90,000. Many are coming to seek higher education as well as better jobs and really just to make a better living for themselves, similar to why my family had immigrated as well in the 80s. And then school district U46, 1% of the student body of the 37,241 speaks Urdu at home, which is kind of a dialect of Hindi, and 2% of Gujarati at home. So even though 1%, 2% sound like a small number, the number of students is actually 372 and 744, so it's a big number. So these are just some interesting facts that I wanted to share as I start to wrap up here. So cows actually can be sacred in some parts of India. They're considered sort of like Mother Earth, a source of goodness. They provide milk to many, many creatures. They're free roaming in India, just like you see in that photo. And that rickshaw in the back is a mode of transportation, as well as a train. I mentioned earlier the population. So this is kind of what happens. If you really want to get on with your day, you kind of have to do this sometimes, depending on, of course, where you are. India is the largest producer of tea. Indians love tea. You've probably heard of cha, or maybe the better word is chai, at Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts. It is always available. So that picture in the top, that is actually just someone at like someone sells cha at a train station. So they'll come out and they'll give you a tea and they'll make sure they get the cup back before your train leaves. I think that's pretty cool. And you can have it at the office. It's really available all day. And then 70% of the world's spices actually come from India, so it is the largest producer of spices, such as turmeric, chili powder, cumin, and saffron. And then we are also known to have the most amount of temples and mosques in India. And India also has the highest percentage of vegetarians. So this is me wrapping up now. I just wanted to remind everyone that we are in this together, especially similar to what Sadia said. You know, we want to live amongst each other. I encourage everyone to stay curious, ask questions when it's appropriate, and, you know, move yourself into that mode of multiculturalism. You know, it really creates stronger teams, more unity when you're uplifting diversity and celebrating diversity. Your heritage has value, your story has value, and you matter. And then there's one more thing that I wanted to share. I would be remiss if I didn't. The Taj Mahal actually is in India. It is one of the seven wonders of the world. It's actually a mausoleum, which the late Emperor Shah Jahan had made for his favorite wife. And then just other cultural things that we bring here too, such as Bollywood dancing and classical dancing. And that's just a picture of Indian ice cream called Kulfi, and that's also one of our favorites. So. That is it for me. Thank you so much for your time and attention. I think I'm allowed to take questions. So, does anybody have questions? Wow, you guys are really easy. Well, thank you so much again. Oh, I'm sorry, there's a question.
India, as I understand it, became a protectorate of Great Britain. And India was referred to as the jewel in the crown of the British Empire. How did the British take over India? We know how they took over America. They were English people sent over here to begin with. But how did they take over India for 200 years?
That is a really good question, and I don't know that I have the exact answer to it, but I do know that they took over closer to the end of the rule of America, and so I think that might have something to do with it. They had more manpower and human power to kind of infiltrate, but I don't actually. I do know that there are some Indians actually who still look up to the Queen and in that type of administration, but I'm sorry, I don't have a better answer for you. If somebody else knows the answer, please jump in. Yes?
It's divide and rule.
Divide and rule.
Because that's a big issue.
Yeah, thank you. Someone here, and then I'll get you in the back. Yes?
Have you ever been to India?
Yes, I was born in India, so came here when I was 4, and then I've been back several times since then. Mm-hmm. Like when I was 7, and then older, and then, yeah. Thank you for asking.
But it actually began with the East India Trading Company in the 1600s. It began kind of with trade, but then they cut off trade from under the control. And then with agriculture and textile, it ended up being, it kind of slowly began in terms of trade, then it was military, and then they kind of, by kind of creating stress in certain parts of the country and overpopulation, kind of created this need to kind of then kind of conquer bit by bit, state by state, side by side. And then it actually ended up replacing Indian indentured servitude, replaced African slavery in much of the British Empire once it was abolished. So, yeah.
Thank you for that. That was awesome. Any other questions? Yes.
Yeah, have you personally encountered any prejudice?
Yes, I have. I think when I was more younger in middle school, sometimes those kids can be a little unsure of how to, you know, I was an immigrant, right? So I really just try to blend in and fit in. And so, but I remember being called names and things like that when I was younger. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The other question I have is about arranged marriages.
Mm-hmm. I think in some parts it is, yes. My parents were actually arranged marriage, and there are some parts of India that do believe in that, and so it is, sometimes you are actually outcast if you choose to not do that, so it just depends. You know, there's things I didn't go into today, like a caste system, and so it just depends on some of those factors. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Sure. I would recommend the Taj Mahal for sure, which is near Delhi, and you fly into Delhi. And there's also a lot of good sightseeing, such as like Jaipur and Udaipur, which I didn't talk about, but there's like the temple that I had showed earlier. That's a big place that people want to go. It's called Somnath. So I would just Google it, like best places to see in India. I know a lot of people like to go to like an ashram too, to kind of see how that atmosphere is like. I would say like north and then, you know, around there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. So this is classical dancing. Classical, yeah, and that's Bollywood. So Bollywood is like from Hindi films and music that came from, you know, kind of like a Hollywood atmosphere. And classical dance, it's kind of centuries old. So it's more poised and more structured and a lot of discipline very graceful movements versus Bollywood is almost like a hip-hop type of dance. So, yeah. Any other questions? I think I saw someone's hand up. Yes.
How many provinces or states make up the country of India?
Many. I don't have the exact number. I mean, we could go back to that first slide, but a healthy amount. How many?
I think it's 22, if I'm not wrong.
22? Thank you. Yeah. Yes. 28. Okay, so somewhere between 22 and 28. So I think I remember telling you guys that I don't know that much. So, did you have a question? That's a really good question, and I could tell you later. That's my daughter. yeah, we'll talk about it later. It's a long answer. That's a really good question. It's been a while. I haven't been back in 13 years. We wanted to go, but then, COVID. I mean, technology. So that's a big change. And having Wi-Fi, that's a big change. My mom just came back last year. So there's a lot of, there's Uber. Uber is huge in India, which of course they didn't have many, many years ago. But personally, I have, seen a lot of poverty when I go to India, so I feel like that really hasn't changed. And that's where I look for the change, I guess. So I'm a little biased in that way, but thank you for making me think that way. Appreciate it. Any other questions that I can try to answer? Okay, well, thank you so much again for entertaining me, and I will pass it on to Kiran. She'll talk a little bit about Pakistan.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Kiran. Can you hear me at the back? Okay. So thank you so much for coming on a weeknight. I know everyone's got a very, very busy schedule. So thank you for making it out here. And as in Pakistan, we would welcome you by saying Assalamu Alaikum, which means may peace be on you. So thank you very much. We will start, but before I start, I wanted to just say again, like Mansi said, I'm not an expert either. I'm your neighbor. I'm just a Pakistani-American that happens to live in Elgin, and we've been in Elgin for the past 12 years, and my kids have gone to school here, so I'm just your neighbor, so I'll try to answer as best as I can. But I think maybe by being your neighbor, I can give you a more realistic view than an expert. So, so let's try to do that. So we'll talk about Pakistan, and this is the flag. And the question that you had asked, we'll try to answer that as well, is because, I think I pressed the wrong button. There we go. So as Mansi said, India was under British rule, and this was all one big country under British rule, and you can see it on the map, until 1947, when the Muslims in India wanted to have their own country. So they wanted to have their own nation where they could be the majority. So that's when, in 1947, Pakistan broke off. So we're still like physically joined, but became a separate country in 1947. There was Pakistan there on the west, and then there was this East Pakistan. And then a few years later, the East Pakistan became Bangladesh in 1971. So the reason was basically because the Muslims wanted their own country, and that's what happened in 1947. So when we talk about Pakistan, just like here in the United States, we have 50 states. So Pakistan is made up of four provinces. Just like you have in Canada, you have provinces. So four provinces, there's Balochistan, Sindh, Punjab, and KPK. So you see the green area on the bottom right, that's Sindh. And there you see Karachi, the seaport. That's where I was born. So I was born in Karachi and the seaport. It's a very metropolitan, hustling, bustling city. And I moved to Chicagoland area in 1999, so around 24 years ago. And then in around 2010, we became naturalized citizens. So because I've been here around 24 years, I'd say approximately half my life I've spent in Chicagoland, and the other half approximately in Pakistan. So when I say I have a hyphenated identity, it's pretty balanced. So far, it's pretty balanced. And then you can see on the map that our neighbors are India, China, Afghanistan, and Iran. And then here we have the Arabian Sea. So Pakistan is the fifth most populous country in the world. Mansi was talking about how India is very populated. Can anyone guess what's the current population of Pakistan? A, B, or C? OK, I hear C, I hear A. What's the consensus? C, OK, most people are saying C, which would be very close to the United States population, correct? But we are at 330 million here in the US. But the correct answer is B, 242, which is still a lot because it's a much smaller space. If you look at on the map, if you look at the size of Pakistan and the size of the United States, you can see that 242 million is one too many. It's very populated in many areas. But yeah, so the correct answer was B. And then the flag of Pakistan, the majority or the biggest part of Pakistan's flag is green, and that's why I tried to find the darkest green that I could find in my closet, is because that's symbolic of the color of Islam, and because Pakistan was made on that premise. So the majority of the flag is green, but there is still the white portion because there are minorities in Pakistan from different ethnicities, from different religions. So can anyone guess? How many or what percentage of Pakistanis are Muslim? A, B, or C? Okay, you think A? C? You think A? You think C? B? Okay, so we have a mix of answers, and the correct answer is C, 95%. So very heavily, yeah. So 95% of Pakistanis that are living in Pakistan are Muslim. And Pakistan has the second highest mountain on earth, so K2. So you know Mount Everest is the tallest and the highest peak. So the second highest peak, K2, is in Pakistan. Breathtaking, isn't it? It is gorgeous. Pakistan's also home to gorgeous scenery, lots of, you know, really, really, like you wouldn't know if this is Switzerland or if it's Pakistan. It is so gorgeous. And much of this is also like kind of untouched. Some of the areas are touristy, but much of it is untouched also, and it's very, very gorgeous. I haven't had a chance to take my kids to these areas. The areas they've been to, like this is a mosque, a very famous mosque. It's called the Shah Faisal Mosque in Islamabad, which is the capital. But what my kids have seen, we try to go every other year because my whole family is there. My mom's there, my aunts, uncles, siblings. So we try to go every other year. So this is what they have seen. This is the Pakistan that they have seen. So they love it. My kids love to go. They get spoiled by their grandparents, by aunts and uncles. They shop, they eat, but they haven't seen the more beautiful side of Pakistan. I want to take them one time, but this is the everyday, this is the traffic that you actually sit through because there's so many people and so many modes of transportation. There's the rickshaws and the buses, and as you can see, the buses are very decorated. And the roads are very, very loud and congested. But because we go for a little while, we're fine. But if the Elgin Police Department would go to Karachi, there is no concept of stopping at a red light or stopping at a stop sign. You just leave home and you hope you make it back. So it's very, very haphazard. So I've driven all my life, but when I go back to Karachi, I cannot drive. I said, no, there is no, I cannot drive in Karachi because it's just, there are so many people and animals and different kinds of transportation. This is the alphabet. It's called Urdu. And compared to English, it starts from the right. So it's like the ABC, but it's got a little few more letters and it starts from the right. And I try to teach my kids who were born and brought up here to speak Urdu, so we focus on the conversation part, but they do not read or write it. And you know, how much can you do? So my kids, I don't think, will be able to read or write. As long as they can speak Urdu, I'm fine. And then some famous Pakistanis. You might have all heard of Malala Yousafzai. So Malala Yousafzai was shot in the head when she was trying to go to school. So that's when, then after she recovered, she became an activist for women education. And then she became the youngest Nobel Peace Prize winner. So this is Malala when she got the prize. And this is Malala now at the Oscars. So talk about a glow up. So this is after that she did go to Oxford University in England, and she, you know, got her degree and everything. So yeah, so this is what she looks like now. But she's one of the most famous Pakistanis that you might know of. And then Miss Marvel, if anyone saw the series Miss Marvel, she is a Pakistani American girl, and the girl who was chosen to play her is also a Pakistani American. So I think that's some pop cultural reference for you. But the Pakistanis you and I would see every day would be your physician or the IT guys. And that's one of the largest waves of immigration was in either the medical field or in IT, in computer software. So if you, you know, these are the most common Pakistanis that you would meet on a regular, on a daily basis, and they might just be your neighbors here in Elgin as well. So, as Mansi also explained, according to the U.S. Census Bureau, in 2021, there were more than 620,000 Pakistanis in the United States. That's a pretty sizable number. And around 35,000 Pakistanis in Illinois. But I feel this number would be higher. I don't know. I have a feeling it would be higher, but maybe some people don't mark the right box in the census. And Elgin is 5.4% Asian. And Pakistan is the 12th largest source of immigrants to the US, which includes me, according to the 2020 census. And then if you look at the map, the highest population of Pakistanis is mostly New York, New Jersey, Virginia, but then Illinois is pretty high too. And then we have Texas and other states. So you see quite a few Pakistanis right here in your school districts, in your neighborhood. Another link to Pakistan in Chicago is that if you look at the Willis Tower, which used to be called the Sears Tower, or the John Hancock Building, so the man that was one of the key architects, or you'd say designers, in engineers, was Fazlur Rahman Khan. And yes, later he did migrate to Bangladesh. So if there are any Bangladeshis in the audience, they once, he's our guy. But he was a Pakistani for one part of his life. And then later when Bangladesh was formed, he did migrate to Bangladesh. But he was one of the chief engineers or architects for both the tallest buildings here in Chicago. And the irony is that the town he came from, the highest building there was 3 stories. And here he came to Chicago, and he was one of the key people who built something which was more than 100 stories high. And then we have a mini Pakistan in Chicago, which is called Devon Avenue. And there you get lots of great food, as well as fabrics and clothes. And they have 2 streets there. One is called the Muhammad Ali Boulevard, and one is called the Gandhi Boulevard. And they're right there, and you see lots of Indian and Pakistani shops. It's in Chicago, near Loyola University. Has anyone been to Devon? Perfect, awesome, yes. So if you go to Devon, you get a kind of a taste of what life would be in India or Pakistan. You'll see the shops, the foods, and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, Devon, I think, is the closest you can get to a mini Pakistan here in Chicago. And then coming to Elgin, we have a mosque here, right here in Elgin. It's right on Bluff City Boulevard. Anyone pass the mosque? You've seen it, right? On Bluff City Boulevard, if you are on 20. So this is called IIE. So this is kind of the closest you could get to seeing a lot of Pakistanis in one place. Although Muslims come from a variety of countries, there are lots of Muslims in India also, as well as, you know, from Arab countries, African countries, and even right here. So, but I'm just to give you a little Elgin perspective. This is what the mosque looks like from the outside in the winter. And this is what it looks like in the inside. So we don't have pews. Everybody, like, they pray while being on the ground, unless someone's ill and they cannot, then we have chairs. Otherwise, it's all carpeted. So this is what the mosque looks like from inside. So another question, what do you think, A, B, or C? Pakistan has had the youngest prime minister, the first female prime minister in the Muslim world, and the youngest Nobel laureate for peace. C? All of the above? You're right, that was a trick question, all of the above. You are right. So you already talked about the youngest Nobel laureate, Malala. And then Benazir Bhutto was the youngest prime minister of her time. She was 35 when she was elected, and at that time she was the youngest prime minister in the world and the first female prime minister in the Muslim world. And the prime minister is the actual person who does stuff. In the constitution of Pakistan, the president is more, he just shakes hands with the dignitaries and stuff. The prime minister is the actual person who does the stuff. So it was a big deal. And she was assassinated some years later, unfortunately. But her son is right now the foreign minister, which is like the Secretary of State. Cricket runs in the veins of Pakistanis. It's like baseball, very similar to baseball, but we just don't have the diamond. We have a pitch. So Pakistanis and Indians too love cricket. And when there's a Pakistan-India match, then it's very heated. But it's a lot of fun too, because it's like one of those, is it the Bears and the Packers? So it's something like that. It's very, very intense. So although the national sport of Pakistan is hockey, not ice hockey, there's no ice there, but cricket is still the most popular sport. From the streets to the fields, everyone talks about cricket. And talking about cricket, the captain of the cricket team, Imran Khan, who won the World Cup, also was one of our most popular prime ministers. So you might have heard of him. He was also Oxford educated. And unfortunately, there's a lot of political unrest in Pakistan. So he's not the prime minister right now, but I thought he's a famous Pakistani, so I should add him. This is the Pakistani rupee. And just like the Indian rupee had Gandhi on it, this is Muhammad Ali Jinnah, who was the main key figure with Gandhi at the time when Pakistan split from India. He was also an attorney and a civil rights activist, and he fought for the freedom of Pakistan. So this is the 1,000 rupee note. So A, B, or C, $1 is how many rupees, Pakistani? Yep, see, 283. So it's fun when we go to Pakistan and we can shop a lot, but it's not really good for the country because of the inflation. Because when I immigrated here in 1999, one US dollar was 50 rupees. So, you know, it's really taken a hit. So while we can say, oh, it's so much fun, we can get so much shopping done, it's not really fun. If they're importing stuff, it's not really fun for the people who live there. So, you know, but currently, yes, $1 is 283 rupees. And unlike the US currency where everything's the same color, the bills are all different colors. So like on Eid, which is our biggest holiday, like Christmas, when kids get money, they can tell from a distance if they're getting 500 rupees. Or if they're getting 1,000 rupees, so they can tell by the color of the bill, which we call a note, a rupee note. So yeah, that is Muhammad Ali Jinnah on the note. This is Eid prayer. Eid is, because I said Pakistan has a majority of Muslims, Eid is like Christmas, the biggest festival. It happens twice a year. So this is people praying outdoors because there's just too many people to fit inside the mosques on Eid. And then everyone puts henna. And that's a very cultural, traditional thing. And these are things that we have tried here, even in Elgin, as the Pakistani Muslim community, we do this for the kids. So even before Eid, someone will have a henna artist come over to their house, and all the girls get together and they put Eid. So these are things we have tried to replicate here. This is a bangle shop. In Pakistan, you can get any color of bangles, and it's the mode of a transaction is different. You have to ask someone to get something for you. You don't just walk into Target and pick it up yourself. So you always, there's a shopkeeper, he's behind the counter, and then you ask him that, can we have this and can you show us this? This is a gold shop. Jewelry is really big and it's also seen as an investment. And many people save money and buy gold, and that's a big thing in Pakistan and India, I know. And this is like fabric shopping. So again, you go to the store and you ask them to match something or take out some fabric, and shopping is a lot of fun. So this is how it used to be nearly all our life. But recently, maybe in the last 5 or 6 years, this is shopping in Pakistan. So we have malls in Karachi too. We have the food court and and everything else. So this is Dolmen Mall, which is the one closest to my mom's place where we go a lot, and it's centrally air conditioned. So the days it's like 120 degrees outside, we go to Dolmen Mall. So shopping has also transformed, and it's a lot of fun to go shopping, especially if you're earning in dollars. And then for musical instruments, there's the sitar. And these are tablas, so they're different kinds of musical instruments in the different provinces. And then at weddings, the dhol is a big thing. Everyone gathers around the dhol and everyone's singing songs and making it really festive with the tambourine. So weddings are a big thing in Pakistan. And this is what a typical bride and groom would look like. This is not a fixed color. Most brides do wear red, but that's also changing. Brides can wear any color they like, but it's not a typical white dress that you would see here. And even the grooms, they can wear any color, but this is a very traditional, typical kind of bride and groom that you would see in Pakistan. And how can I forget? I would be doing injustice to the whole presentation if I did not mention Pakistani mangoes. So if you haven't had Pakistani mangoes, try your best to do it. There were many, many years when they were not allowed to be imported to the United States, but Secretary Hillary Clinton in 2010, it was like a goodwill gesture. There was some political thing behind it, but as a goodwill gesture, she approved for them, for Pakistani mangoes to be allowed in the United States. Now again, Pakistan exports 150,000 tons of mangoes. That's a big export for them, but unfortunately, we still don't get as many here because it's a very delicate fruit, and it's a long distance, and you can't really freeze it, you can't really, you know, expose it to too much heat, so it's got a very short ripening time. So because of that, you don't see it in Meijer or a Jewel all the time. You can go to Devon Avenue and get them, the real Pakistani mangoes, and then you'll say, okay, so this is the real deal. So mangoes are a big, big thing in Pakistan. And then food. We talked about food. Biryani is one of the most common, one of the most stereotypical, perhaps. So the food is very similar to India, but there's a meat involved as well. There are vegetarian dishes too, but a majority of the Pakistani cuisine does include meat. And then we have, you know, other things like lentils and rice. And as Mansi said, we have lots of sweets with the sugar and the clarified butter. So there's so many things that are very similar. But as you can see in the presentation, there are a few things that are different too. And I think the whole objective of this program is so that we learn about one another and we accept the differences. And we don't have to become the other person, or we don't have to agree with everything, but at least we should have the knowledge. We should acknowledge our neighbors that Elgin is pretty diverse, and we could have teachers, or we could have students, we could have coaches from different nationalities or from different origins. And as long as we accept and acknowledge one another, we're all good. Yes. So does anyone have any questions? Yes. Ever have been where?
Mecca.
Yes, I have been to Mecca twice. Once when I was a kid, my parents took me, and then I took all three of my kids. Yes. 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 They are definitely improving. There's always room for improvement. And as far as, like, but even here, if you see minority rights, there's a lot of work that can be done. So similarly in Pakistan with the minorities, there's a lot of work that can be done. And women's rights are improving. I think with social media and with a higher rate of education, slowly and gradually, people are speaking up. Earlier, it used to be that don't air your dirty laundry, or if something's, you know, wrong, don't speak about it. But if today's generation, and I have an 18-year-old and a 21-year-old as well, they're not going to stay quiet, which is a good thing. So I think things are improving. The earlier culture used to be stay hush about things, but it's definitely improving, but there's still a long way to go. Yes. The most visited area, that's a very good question. I'm not really sure, but I think Karachi and Lahore and Islamabad are the three main cities. Islamabad is the capital, and I think you've been there, right? Yes, and then Lahore is a very big metropolitan city, and so is Karachi. Those are the three, I think, most visited. But again, as I showed you, the northern areas with the beautiful landscape and scenery is something that I would highly recommend. If anyone can go, they should definitely go and see that. especially with the rupee conversion, you can stay in five-star hotels and have butlers and everything, and still be, you know, it'll be cheaper than a stay in downtown Chicago. But the only thing would be the airfare. Can anyone guess how many hours is the flight from Chicago to from Chicago to Karachi? 14 hours flying time? Yeah. Yeah, the flying time is around 16 to 18 hours, and it takes you around 24 hours to get from door to door because of the layover and stuff. Any other questions? Yes. What do I think about? I think, you know, raising children here, I'll just laugh about it. And I wouldn't want that for my children. It's not like my kids won't have it. I wouldn't want that for my children. I did not have an arranged marriage, and I would not want that for my children either, because I feel that if it goes great, that's great. But if it doesn't, at least they have no one to blame. So because my kids were born and raised here, there's no way they're going to have an arranged marriage, and that's good. I want them to choose someone that they choose for themselves, because they're the ones who have to spend the rest of their lives. Yes? She does. My 18-year-old does. And she did it on her own. She did it on her own. When she started middle school, I actually told her, why don't you wait until high school? But she started on her own. So, yeah, and then I have an 8-year-old, and she's sitting right in here. But my 18-year-old had work today. So she started on her own, and that was her choice. And I supported it, but it was her own choice. Yes. Any other questions? Yes. That's, again, I'm not very sure about the history, but I think the Bengali people from there, they also wanted their own country. And then there was some, you know, unrest, and some, there was a war. It was called the Civil War of 1971. So there was also, they wanted their own, I think maybe they were not getting their rights or something. They wanted their own country. I'm not exactly sure, but that's what I'm guessing. Okay, thank you very much for your time. Thank you.